No. Thank you. Thank you. Introducing the Charbroil Kettle Grill, a great way to please a crowd. Durable steel, porcelain finish with large 22.5-inch cooking grid and adjustable three-position fire basket. Smoke or slow bake with Charbroil, just $34 through Saturday. A small price to pay to impress the crowd. Kmart is the
saving place. Grab your gift list and hurry into Circuit City's holiday sale. Save now, don't wait. It's the best time to buy with great low prices guaranteed through Christmas. Like a Magnavox 19-inch TV with cable-ready tuner and remote. Only $227.97. And a Sony 8mm camcorder. Enjoy easy operation, power, zoom, and more. Just $899.97. Save now. Don't wait. Hurry into the holiday sale.
Welcome to Circuit City, where service is state of the art.
Thank you. the end.
All right, sounds good.
Except the big question. All right, so good. I think we're coming up.
Thank you.
That's fine for me as well, yeah. I'm happy with video as well.
All right, let's go live. Sure, let's try it.
Okay.
I don't know if it's going to work.
Tell me when to go ahead. I'll start firing away with these questions. I can see something.
Oh, yeah. It's like a frozen picture of me.
Oh, I think that's fine as far as I'm concerned. As long as people have a kind of general indication of your appearance, they don't need to see every single one of your facial expressions and contortions. So.
That's true. I think we might be live now. I'm not sure. We're live, yes.
Okay, I'm going to go ahead then.
All right.
First of all, I mean, I have to say just thanks very much for performing. That was an excellent performance. And I mean, without exaggerate too much, it felt like a journey. It was a very interesting stream of your music all combined together into this kind of very absorbing flow.
Thanks.
And yeah, I guess the live performance brings me to my first question, which I have, which is you were discussing for today that you played recently at the Sled Island Music and Arts Festival. I just wanted to ask, you know, how do you find performing via a live stream compared to performing live in front of an audience of people? Is it different? Do you experience it differently as an artist?
Definitely, it's very different. I think that like I started making this music on the internet with an internet totally anonymous audience in mind. So I think that connecting with an audience and performing is an element of an act that usually is a big factor if you're starting a band or starting something that
for sure. Yeah.
Playing shows. So, I mean, it's kind of retroactive in that sense. Like I've only done a few shows in person and each one's been different. So,
So you mean it's kind of changed the audience response in those cases kind of changed how you view your music. When you see people responding in person to your music, it's had an influence on how you perceive your own music as well.
Yeah, definitely. It's like, I think it's highlighted for me as maybe some people who are familiar with my music with this performance, it's made me want to be more improvisational. Like people want to just see, I don't want to be like it just DJing my own music. I want to have a kind of experimental element to it that I don't really exactly know what's going to happen. And no one really knows if I'm making a mistake or not, I don't think. So it kind of becomes even more exploratory than just making the music like recording it does. So yeah,
for sure. I mean, do you feel kind of less self-conscious and inhibited or more when you're playing in front of a live stream audience? Do you feel more in the music when you're kind of at home playing before a live stream, or do you feel more into it when you're in front of people?
I'd say more into it at home, definitely at home, which I've done very few of these kind of things, but it's like the comfort of my own home, and my cat is here, and I can have a drink or something like that. If I have to go outside and go to a venue, there's just a whole other slew of things to deal with.
I guess it allows you to focus more on the performance itself without worrying about all the additional kind of details and factors you have to take care of.
It's true, and I don't have to worry about the audience. I kind of just get in the zone. If the audience is reacting or not, I have no idea. So, yeah.
I mean, that's what it seemed like when I was watching you. You seemed very kind of involved and immersed in what you're doing there, and that's the impression I took from the music. But yeah, I just wanted to ask.
Right.
Also, with regards to talking about how people respond to your music, I wondered, you know, playing at Sled Island, and I'm not sure of the exact other concerts you've done, but have you found that perhaps at the festival people have been familiar with Vaporwave-related music? Have you kind of been playing to, let's say, the initiated people who haven't been exposed to Vaporwave? Or have you kind of met people who actually are already into it, and you've kind of met fans, and you've played to people, you know, you've played to the choir in a way.
Yeah, it's definitely been a mix. There seem to be a lot of people who know about the scene and know who I am, and then also know about the term vaporwave and the whatever want to call that stuff. And then there's also a lot of people who know about these things, and they don't really know anything about the terminology. I guess it feels sometimes the scene and the terms feel a little insular, in the sense that it's this kind of internet bound, forum bound thing, and then at the end of the day it can be called a lot of different things outside of that. But
definitely.
And I think that it's just been a total mix, and I think that a lot of people, like the people that I opened for, weren't vaporwave, but they were like they had elements of experimental music that DJ PayPal and Orange Julius and Eve's Two More and stuff like that. Just very, very experimental in nature, and could easily be fitted into, you know, this kind of scene, but aren't, I guess. So I don't know if that really answers your question.
Just touched on something I was considering. I mean, do you think if vaporwave or whatever you want to call it now, I realize many kind of moved on from, like they say, the first wave or conventional vaporwave, if we can call it that. But do you think if this kind of area of music wants to kind of move beyond its like niche and be a bit less into, do you think people need to kind of perform live more, like you've done at festivals and so on, and kind of be a bit more proactive in actually kind of getting out there, Canada or touring the US, wherever? Do you think that's something that would be a good idea to do if any particular artists wanted to? Fame or recognition?
You're cutting out there for a second. I think I got you though. I think that escalating it, if that's the right word, progressing into some kind of live act, if the original concept or the artist or whatever is conducive to it, then great. However, I think a lot of the stuff just needs to be kept like weird and anonymous and just totally cryptic, I guess, to the outside world. I think that lends itself to a lot of the stuff that's being made. But as for me, I don't know. I'm just doing whatever, like playing shows. I haven't had a grand vision for like scaling this into something
for
that could be.
You
that
just
could
do
be,
what yeah. you do, kind of. Yeah.
Yeah. So, and as for it becoming more broad, I feel like in a lot of ways that word has like it. A lot of people know what it means now. Which is, you know, that's a big deal for some, I think. And I think a lot of people making the music are just kind of also making something that appeals to them. And they're just maybe, doesn't really matter if it still fits in the box or not. It'll matter to some, but yeah. I don't know if that really answers your question, but I answered some of it, I think.
Yeah, it discusses it, yeah. And I think finally my last kind of Sled Island live performance related question. I mean, I noticed that I was looking at the bill on Sled Island, and I noticed that Flying Lotus was playing there. And I mean, I don't know how accurate this is, but I kind of, even though obviously you're on Dream Catalog and you use a lot of this, video game samples, and so you kind of, that associates you more heavily with Vaporwave, I often kind of think of you as more of like a producer, Flying Lotus, or perhaps someone involved in IDM or glitch music. I mean, is that a fair assessment? What kind of influences do you have?
I'd say that's fair. I feel like I've always kind of fell through the cracks, I guess, of these internet genres. I mean, I haven't strictly tried to conform to any style. I think that, I could make something that would be at home on, like, various labels. I just, and I think the video game element appeals to a lot of people, but I sort of try to, I know it, maybe this sounds ridiculous, I try to keep it subtle in the sense that a lot of my samples are actually not from video games, they're just original compositions that I remix myself. to sound like video game. Like, I've had reviews of the music where people are saying, oh, this is a sample from Final Fantasy VII, and I'm just like, it's not. It's actually not. But I've, this is the first time I've ever really mentioned that to anybody, but yeah.
Sure.
So, so yeah, I like to sort of evoke that kind of stuff, but I think that I don't know.
It's not a massive element of your music. It's not kind of integral to what you do. It's something you...
Yeah, yeah. I think it keeps it... Yeah.
Use...
Keeps it broad-ish, I guess. Maybe.
I was actually going to ask about... I was going to move on to video games. I mean, you use a video game sample, or when you actually create a video game-esque sample yourself, I mean, what element... would you say, of video game music are you trying to capture or evoke? I mean, obviously, in a lot of vaporwave writing, it's often the nostalgia element.
Mm-hmm.
People are kind of, you know, evoking the nostalgia of 8-bit, 16-bit video games. But is there anything else to it when you're inserting video game sounds into music? Is something else you're trying to capture about?
Oh, there definitely is. I think it... The main thing that I do sample, which is I do sample from that PlayStation, that PS1 there.
Yep.
I do sample sound effects, like yep. menus and spells and attacks and things
spell.
Like that. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I that's one thing that I really liked about playing games and just overall using. Anything is like any like interfaces that has sounds to it that interact with the music, and I try to just that was kind of the starting point for me was like, oh, like what does this song sound like if you're going through a menu and doing a bunch of stuff for 10 minutes, it's changing that it's very very subtle and simple idea, but it's changing the music a little bit, and so I sort of started exploring that by like turning them into MIDI controllers and sampling from PlayStation, so. Yeah.
Right. Cool. And I mean, you say you're just using it as a like lighter, more peripheral element. And I kind of noticed. I mean, when you first emerged with OST and sound RPG, I mean, it had more of a central place. Video game music. It seemed like it was more heavily used. But with Veltal, your most recent, it's a bit more subtle and. Recently, your most recent record has been Katamari Fantasy, so it's kind of, you've moved back to it. So I just wondered, I mean, are you going to continue moving away from it, you think, as you did with Veltal, or is it going to be a recurring element in your music, you think?
I think it's going to be, I'm not sure. Like, I think it will come back and sort of never leave, really, but... I kind of use this as like a way to explore composition and rhythm outside of the primary. Like I do a lot of film composition and stuff like that, and that's where I have to basically come up with a melody and tell the audience something. Whereas this project is more like the overflow. It's like a relief cut from that, where it's like the music. I don't have a vision for any song before it's made, and I just explore until I reach it.
Yeah.
And to say that video game elements don't have a central role in it is a little bit ridiculous. Obviously, it's a huge element, but it's kind of so it's exploratory in the sense. So, am I going to slowly edge away from video games or bring video games back in a big way? I'm not sure exactly. I am working on an EP right now, and it's almost done. And I don't
know. Will that be out this year?
I won't make any official announcements, but it will be out this year. And I'll have more information about that at some point. But and I actually did play part of a track from a very new track, the very first thing I played. Maybe it was even audible because of the technical problems, but the very first track that I played was a totally unheard new thing, so from that EP, and I would say it's still kind of the same, but also different. if that makes any sense.
yeah, makes perfect sense. I think one final, I guess, video game related question. I mean, I noticed with your track names and track listings, it seems like they're almost in suggesting or telling a narrative. Like you have, like you say, the different kind of functions you perform, actions you perform in like a RPG, equip, or you start a new game. Are you trying to evoke some kind of story arc or narrative in your records? Because I mean, even though your music is quite, I'd say it's quite fractured at times, it's quite surreal, and then it moves and jumps from place to place. So perhaps you don't think there's like an obvious story arc, but it seems from those track titles that perhaps you are trying to tell some kind of tale or outline some kind of story, perhaps.
Oh, to tell a story. I mean, I think I'm kind of hoping that some people won't take that away from it, and some people will, I guess. I don't necessarily have an overarching vision. I just like to regurgitate and rehash. And so in a sense, it is, I basically, either or. I try, like, I know that sounds like a cop-out, but I don't have an overarching vision for the story, but I like to suggest at it and hope people can build something out of it. Yeah. I haven't. And I think with like everything I'm doing, I'm sort of hinting at that. I mean, with the descriptions of the album and the track names and even some of my tweets and stuff like that, I'm just trying to kind of
insinuate things without stating something explicitly.
Yeah.
Allowing people room to make their own interpretations and kind of invest their own meaning in your music to a certain extent.
Yeah. So that's the sort of crappy answer, but that's my answer.
It's perfectly good. Yeah. No, I appreciate that entirely. I think, you know, a lot of the best music, best art leaves room for the audience's own responses. I think, yeah, that's probably the best, the richest kind of art.
Yeah. I guess in that sense, like, so my goal is like to have somebody who does not care about video games or about anime or about JRPGs and about archetypal stories to just be able to pick this up and just be interested in it, but also to activate that in someone who has that nostalgic history.
Yeah, so who has that?
That's I don't know if I do that so successfully, but I try to go for both, I guess. Yeah. So. Yeah.
Cool. I think I'm about to kind of wind up with my questions, but I was doing some research, like, you know, I guess should, and I noticed that you under the name of VHS Stills, you produce your own clothing, t-shirts and such. I just wanted to ask kind of how that came about and whether it's kind of a piece with your music, whether it's part of your music, or it's just something separate, a different kind of project altogether.
It's definitely completely and utterly linked, I would say. But I don't necessarily advertise that very well. A lot of the textures and samples in the music are recorded by me on VHS, directly from my computer or from a PlayStation, and then back onto my computer and remixed into the music. That was actually one of the reasons why I think people were paying attention to it at first, is because it was just, I made a bunch of songs, I made the song and then I recorded it on VHS and back onto the computer, and became sort of a thing, I guess, that people were interested in. And I actually found a tape on the street like 5 years ago. It was just in a waterlogged cardboard box of like home recordings. And this one cassette VHS tape had like, it said Final Fantasy VII Aeris death scene, like in mechanical pencil by like a child, written on it from like 10, 20 years ago. And then the whole thing is covered. I actually have it somewhere, but the whole thing is covered in like all the different cutscenes from these PlayStation 1 games recorded on VHS. And I just sat there and watched like 3 hours of cutscenes. And that's why I started the VHS Stills. And then that's also why I started R23X. I was like, oh, this tape will provide me entertainment for the years to come, basically. Yeah, that's how I started hooking up VCR to like make new recordings, and then the reason it became a clothing thing was just because I like clothes and I make clothes for a living with the Yeti, which is a a clothing company. I was like, I can turn my VHS things into clothes. So I did that.
That's okay, basically cool. And, my final question, given that you released these main VHS stills, I wondered if you're releasing any other music under R23X. Do you have any other kind of kind of kept secret?
I do
so
have,
you realize it's you?
I do have one other, not much. I mean, I make a lot of music under my own name, or I compose, okay. But I also, which I think is public knowledge, I also have an alias Eternal Showers. Under, I was just released something on the Pyramids label. I don't know if you've heard of that one, but it's a smaller label that does digital only. And it's kind of like, I don't really know what to call it. It's like rain and house and bad audio quality. Basically, that's how I describe it in a few words. Yeah.
That's all my questions. So I'm going to start scrolling through some of these questions that audience members have been typing in. I don't know how much time we have exactly. I don't know whether we can do all of them, but I've some ones. And if you want, look for yourself and suggest any or answer any directly without me being asked, go ahead. But I think the first question, first of all, is that he wants me to tell you that you're amazing and that the audience love you. So just so you know that.
That's nice.
Okay, the first question, Electric Spectre asked, are there any new Vaporwave artists you enjoy in particular?
I don't know off the top of my head. I haven't really been...
Any electronic or rock or whatever musicians you're enjoying?
Basically, for the past few weeks, I've been listening to a lot of Mall Music, Inc.
Oh, really?
Which is just
more soft, or actually just more music, something's...
That's actually the reason that I was listening to that. It's actually a record label. I think it's DJ PayPal's like project of some kind. And I was opening for him, so I was, I should probably listen to some of this. And
yeah.
It's kind of like footwork, actually. I would say definitely is sort of footwork, but has elements of experimental sort of sampling and stuff in it. So, yeah.
Okay, cool. And, Electric Spectre also asked, and perhaps this relates to you saying that you make music under your own name. How did you start music, and do you make any other, up with Vaporwave, or were you making any other kind of music when you first started?
I guess the answer to that, what was the first part of the question?
Basically, how long have you been making music, and did you start with Vaporwave when you first began making music, or did you start another genre?
Right. I kind of just started. I've been making music for a long time, but nothing really coherent aside from like sort of film music, I guess, like orchestrated sounding stuff, and writing for small ensembles and stuff like that is what I mainly would do. And I think I've always toyed around with experimental for me. I don't know if you could call it truly experimental, electronic stuff before this project, but this is the biggest one that I've probably actually committed to, I guess. So just basically composing for film before this. And occasional bands and things like that, but
cool.
Yeah,
rock bands or some other kind of.
Actually, I was in a band. I was in a band like 8 years ago, and it was like we had. It was kind of like electronic, dancey. We'd like live looping and things like that. I played saxophone in it.
It's quite eclectic.
It was. I don't know how to. It sounds ridiculous when I say that, but it was kind of like. I think we were inspired by like maybe Crystal Castles, but with saxophone and a male singer or something like that. Yeah.
Okay, here's another question for you from Finn Levy. Has meme wave gone too far, in your opinion?
I don't even really know. I try. Yeah,
I don't know about that. So.
Yes and no, maybe, I'm not sure. I don't even really understand fully. So.
My assumption would be that it's kind of hard to completely disentangle meme wave from vaporwave to a certain extent, and so you can't really perhaps stop vapor meme the meme wave without kind of somehow disrupting the normal vaporwave. Perhaps that would be my kind of first take, but yeah, I don't know. I don't follow vapor meme myself, so I can't say.
Yeah, I think I'm one of the worst candidates of people involved in these things to actually have a grasp of what's going on.
Okay, here's another one. What was it? This is from SC Crash 420. What was it like to collaborate with Vapera on the song Evil Eye?
Oh.
Contributed what? And how did you work? Was it remotely via email and such, or did you meet?
It was completely remote. He just, Vapera is a really awesome guy. We just became friends on Snapchat, and then I emailed him some stem files of stuff I'd been working on, just like basic isolations of some of my sound effects and vocal samples, and he sort of had a vision for it, I think, after I sent it to him. And he did most of the legwork other than me providing. I basically provided him stems for a song that had yet to be completed for him to basically remix, and his remix ended up being something just more than a remix and an original piece, and I liked how it turned out. So, but it was totally remote, totally, totally separate. Yeah. So,
do you have much contact with other Vaporwave or Vaporwave related producers? Have you met any of them, or has it all once again been via the internet?
It's all been via the internet, except very recently, on a trip to Chicago, I met Equip. Who is, many people think we're in this similar vein, and
yes.
I met him and we just hit it off. He's a great guy. And as one would assume, we just get along perfectly as friends and collaborators. So we're actually collaborating on some stuff, which I won't announce either here, but maybe that's
well,
a
that
miniature announcement.
I look forward to that.
Yeah. So Equip is someone who I've met in real life. Probably other people sorry if I'm forgetting someone that I bonded with or something, and they're like, what? They're not mentioning that we had that great time. But I did see Equip in Chicago, and he's awesome. Yeah. He's coming here, actually, too, to Vancouver. So we're going to make music together. Frozen.
Hi, can you hear me? Breaking
hey.
Up a second now.
Hey.
Can you hear me? Hear me now?
I can hear you now.
Okay, cool. Okay, here's a slightly lighter one. This is from Posy Vibes, who, for the sake of full disclosure, is one of the organizers of this stream. But he asks, what's your favorite
My favorite JRPG? I'm not really sure. I don't have a favorite one. It's too hard to decide. That's my answer. I haven't played enough. I'll come to that conclusion hopefully before
okay.
my death. My favorite Final Fantasy is Final Fantasy IX, though.
Oh, really? Yeah, I played at that time, and I found it the characters a bit too, I don't know, cutesy and twee for my liking, like with the tails and such. I kind of wanted, you know, a grittier one like 8, but it was still very good. So.
I understand.
Yeah.
I'll give one answer for my possible top five. That's not okay. Final Fantasy. It would be Tales of Destiny 2, also known as Tales of Eternia.
In Japan. I haven't played that one, unfortunately. On that related, are you excited by the mini SNES? Were you trying to buy a mini SNES? I heard it has like Earthbound and Secret of Mana and Final Fantasy 3 on it, things like that. Does that kind of thing interest you?
The mini SNES. I think I missed it. I don't know. It's like pre-orders already went up. Maybe I'll try and go to a store and like fight someone for it. But
I'm gonna scalp it. Buy it for $1,000.
I got an NES Classic, but I guess I could sell that on eBay and then afford a SNES Classic.
Okay. Here's another question from Electric Spectre again. What are your main inspirations aside from other music, but when making music, are you influenced in the music world? Does something kind of inspire you about your life or your view of the world to make music?
I mean, outside of other music, I'd say I'm heavily inspired by like films and not just obviously the scores or music, but like just the idea of a cinematic experience, whether it's a play or whether it's a film or a video game even. It's like it has this cinematic element to it, and I think that that is a huge role in me wanting to create, like you even said that the music sounded like a journey of some kind, which I appreciate that feedback, because I'm not necessarily into songwriting so much as I am into creating something that is, you know, on some level enthralling just for someone to listen to and maybe watch, and whether it's, so it's kind of like, I'd say just like, like overall, my life is so tied to stories and entertainment that I just am trying, I'm basically regurgitating that at this point. And I'm just a huge fan of films and video games, basically. I don't really mind my personal life that much for music or anything like that.
Right.
So.
Okay. Yeah. And moving topic slightly, Napoleon Blownapart asks, where do you think Vaporwave is headed as a genre? Big question, probably hard to answer, but go ahead if you can.
I don't know. I don't exactly know where it's been, to be honest. I think I entered peripherally and tangential into it peripherally and am still tangential to it near the end of it's like I wasn't in the forefront of any of that kind of stuff, so I don't know if I'm qualified to say, but maybe you have a good answer for that though. I mean, so it is
I couldn't say. I'm not gonna, I think you know, I can't give any specific of how the sound as such will develop, how the style will develop. But I think, you know, to some extent, Vaporwave is a lot like, it's a way of looking at popular culture. It recycles various aspects of popular culture. It can be used as a kind of a frame for repackaging and commenting on games and music and TV shows. And I think it will continue doing that in the future. There will be different things it will be applied to. Like you have, you know, Simpsons Wave, for example. You have now Trump Wave. I think it can go on doing things like that, where it just is kind of like this ready-made frame. It's a set of, going to be taken to any different kind of subject matter almost that's in the public consciousness. A new kind of vaporwave, whether it be, like I said, Simpson Wave or whatever comes next, perhaps. But yeah, in terms of how the music itself will develop, I can't.
Yeah. I think a lot of people who make or made it have issues with the idea of it being formulaic, I suppose. And then their work is being reduced to a series of elements that can be easily predicted and replicated, which, you know, like once Arby's does a vaporwave commercial or something, you know, like, are we just done? Or like, yeah. So where it's going, who knows though. But that's a really succinct and seems like astute way of putting it though. Like a frame within which to assess
comment,
pop culture. Yeah, that makes sense. But where it's going, I mean, it's in that sense, it's going wherever pop culture is going, but yeah, I mean.
I agree. Yeah.
Music is always changing.
Yeah. You can't predict it.
Yeah.
Okay. I've got a very broad and non-music related. Well, one of them is still related to Vaporwave, but it's quite an involved question, it seems. Finn Levy asks, how important do you feel postmodernism is to the Vaporwave movement? And do you feel that Vaporwave has the capacity to adapt to the metamodernist era?
Well, I don't know if I'm well-versed in like art history enough to be able to like talk about this at length, but I do feel in a way that like it is kind of postmodern. Like anything you can think of can be an instrument or a synthesizer, and anything can be anything basically. And you can put it up for free online, and it could be nonsensical, have no rhythm, have no key, and be like just totally dissonant, and somehow fit loosely into this. So like, that's a pretty bad answer, but like, I do feel like we're at a time where like, anything can be anything. I don't know, that's sort of bad, but like.
No, I understand.
It does.
You're guessing.
Like I've looked back, like I recently watched a film, I can't remember what it's called now, Manifesto. It's like Cate Blanchett just doing a bunch of manifestos of different art movements, and half of them sounded like Vaporwave to me, like Dada and stuff like that. Like,
Surrealism.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And it's like, and even it went up to very, very recent filmic quotes and manifestos from like Jim Jarmusch, and he was just saying like steal things constantly. And it's all intertwined. I feel like in that sense, yeah, it's like we're giving Vaporwave too much credit in a sense as a word and as a movement, but a lot of that is being explored by artists and movements for sure. Yeah.
Okay, and the final question I'm going to put to you, and like I said, it's not at all related to music, and you can decline to answer it if you want. Electric Spectre, do you believe in free will or not? And he also, as a sub question, he asks, is consciousness just the result of brain chemistry or something more? Something non material?
Yeah. I think I'm misanthropic enough to believe that free will is just an illusion based off of physical events happening inside of our brain. The only reason I say that is because I recently read a book by Sam Harris called Free Will, and he's like, he did a TED talk, and he's like, there is no free will. So, and he's like, if you were to switch places with a criminal who's murdered somebody, like atom for atom, brain for brain, you know, like, if you were to just, there is no way to trace some other element that if you switch places with them, you would murder, you know? So that's as far as I'm going to go down the road. I believe in free will? Yes and no. I don't know. Read the book Free Will by Sam Harris.
It's a good plug.
To plug that. No reason at all.
Okay, I think we can leave it there. I think we've talked for long enough, and once again I want to say thanks very much for performing. It seems like from the messages that people are leaving that they enjoyed it very much, and I enjoyed it a lot as well, and thanks for taking the time to talk with me and to talk with the audience as well.
Yeah, thanks for having me.
I also like to say thanks to the organizers for inviting me to do this, and also to Empyreal. By the way, have visuals were excellent, and a lot of people were praising them, and they deserve a lot of recognition as well, I think. Other than that, I don't know what else to say.
Yeah, that's